I wanted to talk with you about your entrepreneurial youth. If you could share with us some of the experiences you had, maybe some of your favorite experiments that you had as a kid, and chart for us kind of how old you were when you're having that time of your life early on, and maybe what some of the lessons were that you gathered from those experiences.
I was a resourceful kid. So, you know, started with baseball cards and then sort of moved into stamps and gold and silver, you know, and then into the stock market. And then the first job I got when I could actually drive. So this was, you know, five or six jobs into my work experience. And I was working for the Houston Post newspaper. And my job was to call people on the telephone and convince them to buy the newspaper. And the first kind of partial month I worked there, I figured out that when people wanted to buy the newspaper, either they were, you know, moving into a new house or apartment, or they just got married. The way you find people just got married is you go to the county courthouse and they have the applications for marriage licenses, which are a matter of public record in the state of Texas. And there's an address on the application form that says where you want the license sent to. So that turns out to be a really good place to send people an offer to get the newspaper. The other thing I found was that you could actually get lists of people who had applied for and received mortgages. And that was another great list of people. So my first full month at the paper, I was the top salesperson of newspapers. I was having a great time. This was kind of a summer job. So I started kind of hiring my friends and sending them out to all the surrounding counties to collect all these lists of people that had applied for marriage licenses, and just had a blast. I was 16 years old.
And the result of that was that I think you not only were doing something beyond what other kids were doing, they were getting allowance, but you actually got wheels out of this. What was the result that you had from building this little mini empire of yours in the newspaper business?
Yeah, I saved my money and bought a new BMW.
So you made how much?
When I was at my senior year in high school, we had this project in our government and economics class, and the project was to fill out our tax return. And my teacher was really upset with me because she thought I'd, you know, made a mistake or did it wrong because I made more than she did. And she never kind of forgave me for that.
So when you think about how this relates to your business now, what's the piece of advice or lesson that you would leave for someone who started a newspaper route or was an entrepreneur in their youth as you were?
You know, it's experiment and look for new ways of doing things, be resourceful. I mean, I learned an early lesson in the value of getting a direct contact with the customer and not doing it in a random way, but doing it in a very targeted way. I've always believed in sort of looking at the problem in a different way and, you know, being resourceful.
How would you characterize the startup of Dell Corporation? You were there in your bathtub reassembling circuit boards, not going to class, and being resourceful again. How would you characterize that experience?
At the, you know, beginning of the kind of development of the PC, what we know of as the PC today, you know, there were all sorts of stores that were selling PCs, and they kind of dedicated computer stores. And, you know, as a customer, I observed that it took a very long time for the technology to actually get all the way through the manufacturers, through the stores, and then to the customer. And it had an incredible cost by the time it got all the way through this long, complicated process. And the people who were selling the products in the stores were really just kind of jumping onto a fad. They said, oh, this is the computers are the new thing in the 80s. Let's open a computer store. And it was a franchise kind of model. And so there were a lot of these stores popping up. And so as a customer, I was frustrated. It cost too much, took too long. People in the store didn't know anything about it. And I kind of said, oh, it's got to be a better way to do this, you know. And I started, you know, having taken apart, you know, more than a few computers, understanding what's inside them, I started by selling upgrade kits for computers. The memory, the hard disk drives, at the time the PC didn't have a hard disk drive. So I would buy hard disk drives, I'd buy controller cards, I'd make cables, I'd write software to essentially, you know, upgrade a PC. And that was really the origins of the company, you know, in my dorm room, and kind of grew from there. Within about a year, we started to make our own PCs, which it turns out wasn't that hard to do because all the components came not from the guys who were making the PCs. They came from, you know, the microprocessor company, the disk drive company, the power supply company, and so, you know, using this belief that by working directly with the customer, we could get them the technology faster, provide a better level of service, provide better value. That was sort of the basis of the business. So the company grew about 80% per year for 8 years in a row. So we screwed up all kinds of things, but the fundamental business system was quite powerful and, you know, delivered lots of value to our customers.
I think you characterized it as a series of experiments, most of which failed, but none of which was so large that it transformed the company in the wrong direction.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, you know, we screwed up a lot of things, but the one thing that we really got right was this core business model, and it sort of masked any other mistake that we made. And we learned pretty quickly. We'd try something, if it didn't work, we'd go do something else. Because, you know, at my high school, they didn't really teach us a whole lot about how to run a big computer company. So I was sort of making it up as I was going along. Hiring the best people we could, but, you know, as a company with no venture capital, private company, non-public, you know, you're attracting only a certain special kind of risk taker.
So, Michael, as you're thinking about the time that you had as an entrepreneur, as a kid, and the experiments that you had, and the success of really identifying a consumer need as a youth over and over again, how did that really empower you to develop an organization like Dell?
It's a good question. I'm not totally sure. I think listening, resourcefulness, you know, I kind of, you know, I've always been curious, and my curiosity has been rewarded. So I continue to be curious. So I just look for new ideas, look for new approaches, don't really accept the status quo, don't tend to be satisfied with the way things are, and it's just kind of, you know, in the wiring.